Now I'd like to introduce you to the LaserTech Zone Standard. This allows you to standardize your cues to work with smaller and larger shows, with fewer and greater number of projectors. The standard has 57 zones, the first 16 are the most common, which are available in the 4x4 preview window that we see here. So these are the zones that you would use probably most commonly, and in the case where you're using one monitor, you can easily see them here. So let's have a look at the zone standard in the universe. In some situations, we have only overhead zones or upper zones. So we'd be doing our laser show with multiple projectors and just having stuff aiming overhead. So that is what we see here with the top row of zones from left one, left two, left three, and so on, all the way across to right one. In other situations, we'll have an upper zone, and then we'll have a mezzanine, you know, in between levels. If there's two levels in a theater, then we might want to have a second zone for each projector across that goes across the mezzanine. That second lower set of zones might also be a downstage zone. So you might want to have a zone for each projector that terminates on the front edge of the stage. And then the third row going across that we see labeled left one crowd, left two crowd, left three crowd, those are audience scanning zones for each projector. So in the case where you're doing show where you have audience scanning, you would be using those zones. And up top we see we have four graphic zones, graphics 1, 2, 3, and 4. Those zones can be assigned from any of the laser projectors and moved around depending on your show site. We also have five other graphic zones, which we can see over here in the list. We have graphics 5 through 9 as well, in case you're doing a graphic show with more than four laser projectors. Now, the way the laser projectors are assigned to these zones, if you look at the laser projector on the far left, and then you look above it, that projector will project to left one crowd, left one lower, and left one. And then the one next to it projects to all the left twos, and then you have the left threes, and so on. When we create cues, if we assign them to nine projectors, it will remain compatible with a different setup using less projectors. So this is what I want to demonstrate, and I encourage that when you create your cues, set them up or create them with as many projectors as possible. In the situation where you're using more lasers for a show, your cues will work. In the situation that you're using less lasers for a show, your cues will also work. Now, why is that? Let me start a demo cue here. Okay, now this cue we see goes across nine projectors. It's a multi-cue, multi-projector cue. It could also be a capture that would do this. So in the case where we have nine projectors, this is what we would see. If you were to take this same cue and go to a show where you would have eight projectors, well, you probably wouldn't have a center projector, so you'd have four projectors on each side. So if I click on the eight projectors universe tab up here, it eliminates the center row, and we see that our cue still plays across the eight projectors. In the case of seven, well, we would have a center again, and we have three on each side. In the case of six, the center disappears. We would just have three and three. Five, we have one in the middle, two on each side. Four would be just two on left side, two on right side. Three, we'd have a left, right, and center. Two, we'd just have a left and a right, and one projector, just one. So this gives us flexibility to reuse all of our cues with pretty much any number of projectors. Now what if we only have upper zones at a show? And we've created cues that use upper and lower zones. Well, there's a solution to that. There's a new feature in Beyond that was recently added a few days ago called Zone Routing Replace Zone. Now what this allows us to do is, here I've created these force buttons. The force buttons will do one of two things. They will take whatever is playing, and you can force it, for example, in this case, if I want to force everything only to the upper zones, I would press force upper, and it would shift everything up top here. So it's a nice effect. You'd be able just to switch back and forth. If I wanted to force them all down lower, I could force lower. And if they were all playing up top, I could force them to a stagger configuration as we see here. Now I'd like to show you how this zone routing replace zone works. So I'm going to go to the edit button. I'm going to select force upper. We'll go to the inspector. We'll go to the master effect. It's an effect. So if we see in our list of effects now, if we go to add an effect, well, here's all the ones that most of you recognize. And here we have two new ones. And this one that we're using right now is the zone routing effect. Replace zone. Now in order to do this, you have to create for each zone separately, you have to give it a replacement. So if we look at this left one, in this case here, so what we're telling it to do here in this part is left one, zone left one lower will go to left one instead. So it's going to switch from anything that's playing in this zone will now be switched to this zone. You have to do it in, create them, these changes independently for each zone as an effect. Now I'd like to show you two buttons that I've created up top for fog and haze control. These buttons are linked to DMX output. So if we look down here at our DMX monitor, if I was to click on the haze button, you see the output down here, and notice the lines are thicker, so we've increased the width of these bars so they're much more visual. So we have one button for haze and one button for fog. These are toggles, so we can control our fog like this. And what I'll do is I'll show you how these buttons were created. So if I go to edit, let's go to haze, go to the inspector. These are buttons that are actually scripted. So I've set them to toggle mode. And if I go down to the bottom here, we can have a look at the Pango script that I've assigned to that button. So we'll click on edit. So on this button, I've labeled it as Haze Button DMX Channel 2. And we want to toggle it on and off. So there's a little trick, and you might want to use this. Well, everybody's going to have a copy of this universe setup afterwards. So you can use this as an example or a copy paste to create similar things. So what I've done here is, if you see on change, so basically when there's change, something's going to happen. So the first line here, it detects alternate changes. So every time you press a button, every second time you press a button, the value will be greater than 0.5. That's how the detection process happens. So if the value is greater than 0.5, that means the button's been pressed for the first time. It goes to the start process. Start process is just a label that I put to create a routine down here. So it goes to start process, it initiates DMX channel 2 output level 255, so it's going to turn on our hazer, and then it exits. Next time, the second time that button is pressed, the value is no longer greater than 0.5, so it does not go to the start process down here, it goes to here, and it turns off the DMX channel 2, it turns it to value 0. So that creates our toggle on and off with two different events that can happen. You can also create a loop down here in this start process. So if you want to create something with a loop that happens until the button is pressed a second time, you can do that down here. If you are going to create a loop, it's very important though in your loop to add a function called sleep, which is just a delay timer. Sleep 200 would be recommended. What that does is it allows the loop not to run too quickly, and it's a little bit easier on the system resources.